Hello, 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 and welcome to the Shelly Show. I'm Shailendra, and you're watching this simulcast live on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, Twitch, and YouTube. I hope you're safe and observing the protocols in your area so that we keep each other healthy, safe, and secure. If you've joined us now, then please let me know which part of the world are you watching us from, which city, which country. Please put that in the comment section so that we know where are you coming in from, where are you watching us from. I also want to understand the reach that I've got, so please put that in the comment section. For you to view this episode and other sessions that I run on Emerging Technologies Live, I would request you to follow me so that you can be alerted when a live session is on. This gives you an opportunity to directly ask questions to my guests, to our guests, to your guests. So please press the follow button on LinkedIn and Twitter. Press the subscribe button on YouTube. And for maximum reach of this episode, please like and share this episode to whichever platform you're watching it on. Please like, share. And if you're watching it on Facebook, please share this video to groups that you've got, that you're on, so that people in other groups also understand things around emerging technologies and what we bring to the table. Okay, today's guest, and I'll not just fumble around, we'll quickly get into the meat of it. Today's guest is an old friend of mine. I met him around about, 10, 12 years ago at a conference. And that's where we started our association. And I happened to speak to him a couple of weeks ago again. And so I thought I'll bring him on. So our guest today is Satya Upadhyay. He is an experienced people leader and practitioner strategically optimizing and managing marketing processes. Marketing automation capability and governance. So we'll talk about marketing, digital marketing, optimization, and all that stuff today. Currently, he's the vice president at Citibank Australia, and over the past 15 years, held marketing capability and operations roles within Accenture, The Star, Tabcorp, NRMA, Bankwest, and HSBC, mostly in the banking area. Well, one more interesting fact here is that after I left Accenture, he joined Accenture as well. So he's part of the same team that I was part of. So I'm sure a lot of people who are part of our common team are watching this. And if you do watch this, please say that in the comment section. Okay, over his professional journey, Satya has championed taking businesses on the transformation journey from the present state to the future state. Build target operating models with the understanding of business problems and connecting the dots across people, process, and technology. The basic fundamentals of any consulting environment, campaign orchestration and decisioning engines, development and implementation of customer lifecycle culture with a shift from product to customer first. So without any further ado, let me bring in Satya Upadhyay. Drum rolls for him. Guys, here we go. Satya. Hi, Satya. Welcome to the Shelly Show. How are you doing?
Very well. Thank you, Shailen. It's a pleasure to be here. Good afternoon to you and good afternoon to all our viewers watching from different parts of the globe today.
Good stuff. Thank you, Satya. Thank you for taking time out. Okay, Satya, I did a very poor job of introducing you. Can you please go and introduce yourself for our guests, for our audience, to tell them where you come from and who you are so that people know you?
Thanks. I think you've done a great job, Shailen. So I wouldn't actually go into my professional introduction. I'll do a bit of my personal introduction and my journey as to how and where I came from. So I came from India way back in about 2001 as a student to Australia. And since then, I've been in Australia pretty much now born and bred in the Australian culture and the Australian way of living. I started my journey. I came here as a student in 2001 and I did a master's course from University of New South, University of actually Western Sydney in IT. And then gradually I made my way up. And in 2004, I joined HSBC, did some work there for a while. And then I was picked up from HSBC. Hey, Satya, it looks like you've got a bit of a marketing stint. What are you doing? And they sponsored me to do a master's of marketing program from the University of New South Wales. And since then, there's been no looking back. I spent about 5 years at HSBC, then moved on to NRMA. And from then NRMA, I moved on to Bankwest, where I implemented their intelligent marketing infrastructure, which was more around how do you actually create a campaign management system, a lead generation system, and an outbound inbound integration systems. And then based on my work from there, again, there was a big project happening at NRMA. And I had a phone call from the GM for business intelligence saying, Satya, we got a big project happening and we'd like to offer you a role back at NRMA if you're interested. So I went back to NRMA again. I did a stint there for about 2 years and then moved on to Citibank to do a contract role for a period of time. And from there, I was picked up by the Star. I did some work with Star, and from Star, I was doing some work with Accenture, and then I got picked up with Accenture. And that's how the relationship with Accenture started off with in the CMT division. I did some work with Accenture, then I got picked up with a startup that was doing some work with Tapcorp, did some interesting work again in the data-driven space of trying to get that data communication, orchestration, marketing, ag tech together. And then over a period of time, then now at Citibank for the last 2 years.
Interesting. You mentioned data-driven marketing. So tell us over the years how that has evolved. How have you seen that evolving while you've, because your journey right from the early 2000s to up until now, what do you see that, what is the change that you see in the market?
I think the marketing itself has gone through a very big transformation. And when I was at Accenture, I wrote a paper which is called The Future of Marketing. And that's where I started looking in this a bit more detail. So the way I would classify that, you know, when I was a student of marketing in the early 90s, and you know, the way marketing is described was from a Kotler's lens. You know, Kotler was called the father of marketing. He wrote that book. It was more around the above the line marketing, which was more around branding, communication, PR. Media was print, television, cinemas, that way. Then there came an era of 1990 where you started looking at analytical marketing, which is more around data-driven marketing. And you started looking at, you know, how do you actually communicate with the customer from a data lens? And that went on till about 2000. And as we move into 2020 or 21, now the concept of cognitive marketing is coming through. So now, so earlier above the line, then you have data, and now it's more around technology leading the path in terms of artificial intelligence, machine learning, virtual reality, augmented reality. But what's happening now in marketing is more it's experience led. And what that means is that experience really starts playing a very, very big role. So me and you are having a conversation, we are having an experience, and that experience drive the next generation of marketing of what you need to do. And I'll give you a good example. So let's say, take ourselves 20, 25 years back when we want to watch a movie. It could be a super hit movie, you know, it's a blockbuster. The success of the movie itself was determined by the fact that how is the movie, the cast in the movie, the play and everything. Now everything is connected as an experience. So the movie itself has a part to play with it, but there are other ancillary units that which are connected that starts playing an important role. And that's, let's take an example. What people normally do today, before they go to the movie, they go with their partner, they buy popcorns, they buy cold drinks, they basically get some things, and then they basically proceed towards the theater. Now, if they have a bad experience just before entering the theater, just in that interaction, getting the popcorn and cold drinks, that actually has a domino effect on the movie experience as well. And that's what cognitive marketing and, you know, customer-led experiences is all talked about. So marketing, the way I would describe now, is very experience-led, and that experience really becomes a very, very fundamental part of how you interact with the customer. That's how I've seen marketing evolving over the last 50 years.
So thank you very much. Guys, two things. If you've got a question, put that in the comment section. I'll take that for sure. And, you know, the basic idea of getting all these senior leaders to you is to showcase what's happening in the market, you know, with these all industry leaders who come in like Satya, they talk about these products and these services that you see in the market, whether it is in digital marketing area or something else, and you know, you learn from it. So it means a lot to us if you press the like button and if you share it around, share this video with as many people as possible. And also that helps those other people who actually miss this live to actually learn from these guys. So I will really appreciate if you could like this video and reshare it on whatever platform you're watching in, whether you're watching it on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, wherever you're watching this, please share it. And also, please, if you've got a question in your mind, this is your time. Put that in the comment section and I'll take the question. And like and hearts really encourage us, so please put them there. Okay, coming back to you, Satya. So there is an element of technology and data that's playing an important role in digital analytics, or you know, analytics marketing or digital marketing, as you whatever name you want to give it. Can you share some examples and insights where you've implemented something that is really sophisticated? We started with a POC and went into a large rollout. Share your experiences around it, please.
That's a very hard question, but a very interesting one as well, in terms of some experiences that I have, how you link data and technology and bring that thrilling experiences. So let me think. Something that I've done at Star was really, very exciting. And Star Casino, you know, one is casino, second is hospitality. You know, it's all about thrilling experiences anyway in a hotel and nothing like a five-star hotel. One example that I looked at, which we did a POC, which was really a great concept of how do you actually, because, you know, you're looking at data in real time, and how do you actually put that data and use the sophistication of technology to bring some live experience through. So it's like me and you are talking with each other, right? And this is where you say, you know, data has a lot of value, and how do you actually harness the data? So exactly, how do you collect data, how you store data, and how do you actually reuse data and reuse data for marketing purposes? This is an example of using data for marketing purposes. So for example, the POC that I did at Star was, Shalane, that you like coffee. And this is my favorite example all the time. So rather than me asking you all the time when you're there, Shalane, the coffee, which coffee? And I exactly know that first, as a gaming behavior, Shalendra, what he does is when he basically arrives on the table, the first thing he'll say, I want a coffee. So the next time what I could do is that now I could use beacons and location-based services. And as soon as Shalendra is coming in the property, I get a buzz. He's on-prem. And that means that that gives an indicator to the restaurant or the butler or the back of house, prepare his coffee. And as Shalendra is moving through the car park to the table, the coffee is getting prepared and the coffee is getting served. Now, the only thing that you've got, maybe he's changed his mind. So why don't I send him a text message saying, welcome on board, same cappuccino or yes or no. And you basically confirm that, and that basically triggers off and you go there. We created another twist in there. So maybe you are sitting, and you know, this is again looking at data and data talking to you and deep diving into your data element. Gamers have a very specific behavior. You know, they like to sit on the same machine. They like to play the same game over and over again, day in, day out. So again, your example, Shalendra, you're sitting on table number 12. Me and you basically meet after a decade. And we decide, because my favorite table is table number 24, which is on the south. So what happens there? So you decide, okay, today I'm going to be sitting with Satya and we're going to basically be talking. But now, rather than having a table number 12, which is in the north, we go to table number 24, which is in the south. That information through beacons and location-based marketing through your mobile phone gets relayed back to the butler, explaining him that Shalendra is now not sitting on table number 12, but now moved to table number 24. So the coffee needs to be delivered at table number 24. So that's the type of POC that we've done, you know, and it's all about trying to, you know, when we talked about this 2020 and beyond, it's all about show me that you know me. And the experience is all about empathy, exclusivity, and bringing the emotion and with the use of data and bring that through. So that was one POC that I've done.
Okay. Do you know why I was smiling? Because 2003, 2004, when I was in India and we had I was running a little company of my own, and we did exactly this. We were very limited by technology at the time. So I'll just replay that and just try to think how it matches. So there was a pub called Delhi Devils in South Extension. I don't know whether that exists. Guys who live in Delhi, please tell us whether that pub still exists. I haven't been to that pub for a while. It's like 15 years, 16 years, 17 years ago, 2004. Delhi Devils was the pub, and I went to see this guy who was the owner of the pub, and I asked him, you know, I can do something for you. He said, what? I said, well, we'll do some personalization for you. I said, how can you do that? I said, okay, we will create a card, a loyalty card for you. So when a person walks in at the door, so the Delhi Devil was on, I think, second floor. So the opening was on the ground floor where the entry was. So there was a man standing there. There will be a RFID reader there. The person can swipe the card. And the bartender up there will get a few triggers. He will get to know what beer I like to drink. which seat I like to be on. And when I reach upstairs, that person will come in and say, "Hi, Shailendra, how are you? Would you like to drink your regular Kingfisher?" Now, look at the difference, the kind of experience that you had at that time. Now, what that did, and so honestly speaking, what that did, come Christmas 2004. And what happens in India in Christmas, during Christmas time, is that most of the shops are closed from 24th to 31st. Things are not that moving. If people are on holiday, people want to spend time with their family, they don't go out during that time. So that was a low time for that bar, Delhi Devils. So what the, we did a campaign. We invited people to come in to attend the show, whatever was going on at that time. And do you know that we made such a big change in the revenue model? You couldn't believe it. It was like absolutely great game changer. I don't know, guys, if anyone is from Delhi watching this, and if you happen to be at that place and if you experienced that, we did that 15, 16, 17 years ago.
That's a great example. So it's like, you know, it's Arame used to describe this very well. Is you know what you know, and you also know what you don't know. And I think that's the biggest conundrum or challenge that I find today with marketing is that you don't, and no one's there to actually enlighten you of what fascinating things that you could do with data and technology, and the way you can, you know, come up with a we call in consulting languages the MVP, minimum viable product, and then start working on that, and over a period of time through a phased delivery, and I guess, you know, that's, you know, the experience that you provide is like, you know, customer first, thrilling experience that you're providing to a customer, which is parallel to none.
Absolutely, you know what? He's stolen something from my book. It says, there are things we know we don't know we
do. Oh, God. So it's because so many similarities, I just did not realize that.
So this is copyrighted. And this was copyrighted 3 years ago. No, and there are things we don't know we don't know. And I'm in the business of finding things we don't know we don't know. Anyways, so guys, this is excerpt from my book, Making Money Out of Data. Exactly what he's just mentioned. And I tell you, Satya hasn't got the copy of my book. And he hasn't read that book.
I am just surprised because, you know, sometimes it happens, you use these phrases and all of a sudden you actually come in, you know, I am thrilled, you know, you can see from my eyes that way, that you are making a quotation and you're standing on podium and talking about it. All of a sudden the author of that comes in and say, "Hey, the line that you're actually talking about, that's me." You know, quite my day.
So, yeah, that's, by the way, that's my line and I wrote it. I actually wrote it 20 years ago, and then when I wrote the book, I brought that in. I wanted to make sure that I've got all those quotations there. So this was part of one of the chapters. Okay, let's move on. It's about you. Okay. So marketing technology, but before that, guys, if you're enjoying this, please don't forget to press the like button and share this video with as many people as possible, and please don't forget to follow and subscribe to whatever channel you're watching. I'm so sorry, but I'll keep on repeating that because I want more and more people to watch this episode. I'm really, really enjoying it. Okay, coming back to marketing technology. So, you know, when I started doing marketing analytics 6-7 years ago, there were very few vendors. Now that space is actually getting very big. People who are providing marketing solutions are providing at a very low level digital marketing facilities. Some are providing high-end marketing mix modeling. So there's a whole range of work that is happening at this stage. What challenges do you see with the CMOs and the CXOs? And one more thing, in the last show, we agreed that in the current environment, they need to drop the middle letter. So it's not CMO anymore, it is C, drop the letter O. So you are a CEO, for whether you are CMO or a CIO, you are just a...
Now, when it comes to leadership, you know, whether it's the C, and I'll drop the middle letter, and we'll talk about the O in that way. Their challenge, firstly, is that they look at this as a shiny toy. So this shiny or new toy, and in that landscape, this is always talked about a toy. This has to be integrated with an existing system that we call is a legacy system. Now, with the new system to be integrated with the legacy systems, you know, you're looking at configuration, consolidation, and integration, which sometimes looks simple, But reality is, it's not that simple. So there's a lot of work that goes behind it, and there's a lot of dollars that needs to be spent in making it happen. So that's your biggest challenge that you've got. And then all of a sudden, what happens is that you start buying these technologies one by one. Then you realize, if you look at it in hindsight, that to do the same thing, you've got three different instruments. So effectively, you are duplicating a lot of your infrastructure to provide a similar type of things. And then you start looking at, which one do I use for one? Which one do I use for the other? And then you start communicating with your customers through 1, 2, and 3. Then you start having multiple communication, disjointed communication. And if you go into the crux of, you know, you have contact policy issues and your marketing opt-out, that's another conversation for another day. Then the other thing that you've got is your budget. And so what has happened is that the C-level people, sometimes they miss out the fact that the budget focus is always on the technology or the software infrastructure. Whereas what you also need to cater for and factor is the change management aspect. And the change management aspect is the ongoing maintenance of that infrastructure, the people that you need to lubricate and oil that machine, and how do you actually get that? And so that's the other biggest challenge that you've got. And then the training that needs to be provided and the ongoing training that needs to be provided for that system. So people actually don't really take that into consideration. Then when you're at a C level, the other thing that happens, and apologies if we have our vendor friends on the conversation, is that what you call it, shadow MarTech or shadow IT. And shadow IT is all about when the vendor starts playing a role of the IT in the marketing space. Ideally, what needs to happen is that the CIO and the CMO needs to collaborate with each other in terms of, because the CIO exactly knows what their technology ecosystem is and their infrastructure layout is and what the business requirements from the CMO is, and plug that together. Because they're not having these conversations and both of them are not really understanding their operating model, the vendor comes in and starts doing the job of the IT. And as a result of which, for them to sell their product, it basically, they slip it in saying, oh, it's a very small integration. You can be IT, you know, IT independent in managing that. And that's where the pitfall is. A lot of CMO or marketing leaders fall in that trap that we can actually operate without the assistance of IT. And then that's the other gap that you've got. Then you've got a manpower expertise in marketing or technology to manage this beast of marketing technology. So the way I describe is that marketers are real, and when I say marketers, they're behavioral marketers. They're really good at carving out the theoretical concept of a customer journey. You know, I'm talking to you, what I need to do, grow, retain, win back, prospect, suspect, all that. But when you have to weave that through the data layer and pass that different data through technology systems, it's basically a bit of heavy lifting for them. And at this stage, they're not really fundamentally trained to do that type of work. That's the other challenge that you've got. Then when you go into the buying process, what happens is that whether it's tech people buying it or marketing people buying it, sometimes, you know, the end user is not actually taken into consideration. So what exactly are your use cases that will determine the success and failure of your infrastructure that you're buying? How do you determine that? And the best way to do it is get everyone involved in that journey. So it's not only about the leadership team, but the real ground people that are going to be using it. Those are the few things that I think are challenges in the marketing technology space that leaders both in IT and in marketing should be aware of.
Interesting. Okay, I will come back to you. Just give me a second. Guys, we're around about 25 minute mark. I've just looked at the numbers. There are around about 30-35 people watching this live across the platforms, which is a great thing. But don't forget to like and share this video so more people learn. I'm really, really excited about this particular video and interview that we're going on. And also, please don't forget to ask a question or anything that you think will be worth sharing. I'll take that in the audience Q&A section at the end. So please put your comments in the comment section. Whichever platform you're watching in, it will seamlessly come here and I will share it with you guys. Having said that, I've got an interesting thing for you guys. All those people who are watching on LinkedIn, to improve your LinkedIn profile, I've created an app. And that app is available on both the Play Store and the App Store. I'll quickly give you the link for that. So what you can do is you can actually go to Play Store and look for Link Plus AI, or even if you've got a phone, just scan this QR code and use that invite code 611074 to actually use the app. It is free. There are no ads on it. And it is invite only. So what I've tried to do is help you guys improve on your LinkedIn profile. It also tells you how you're projecting yourself to the world using LinkedIn. It is absolutely free. There is no caveats to it. And also it is got no ads on it. So guys, but it is invite only. So you need to use that invite code 611074, available on both App Store and Google Play Store. So you can download whichever phone you're using. All you need to do is just scan it or search for Link Plus AI and you'll be able to watch that and take the app. A cool thing about it is that it does a word cloud for you, what you look like on or what people see about you. And you can also create a very interesting profile overview card of yourself, which you can share around as well. But anyways, coming back to Satya. And Satya, I've got a question for you, which actually is triggering me a lot of thoughts, which is around the fact that, do you think that the C-level actually understand the concept of analytics, marketing analytics, and how it actually can make a difference? Or is it still that people are still learning at that level? What do you see?
I think people are still learning at that level. That's what my understanding has been. And the reason I say that, you know, if you look at from a data capture perspective and data usage perspective, of all the data that have been captured, what percentage of data is actually utilized? Mm-hmm. And there's a concept of, you know, dark data. So there was a research from IDC, which says that it's only about 43% of the data that's actually captured is actually utilized for anything. So if I go back to my opening statement, you know, the fundamental of for success from a data perspective and analytics is how data is captured, how data is stored, and how data is used. So this in usage, I think that's where we come in, is one is analytics, and the other one is marketing communication. There's a lot of, and that's why when you talk about, you know, personalization and hyper-personalization, that's about the depth of the relationship. I think to a degree, we are still there in the first name, and we've got a few variables where we can identify a person and we can personalize that and try to deepen that relationship. But really looking at all the different beautiful facets of data, and are we actually managing that? I don't really see that. You know, there's a lot of talk about data being the new oil, data being the new currency. So in that, you know, let me add another one. You know, data could be the new oil paint. And there's the beautiful person, Scott Brinch, has been talking about the oil paint. So it's important that he doesn't say that, Satya, you use my word without my permission. but the oil paint, you know, when we, and I think I remember when 10 years ago when you were leading at Woolworths, you know, there was people who were talking, we've got a head of analytics who's a super gun in analytics. And he basically, how do you actually paint the role of an analyst is to paint the picture, tell a story. And how do you actually join those different dots? So if you look at that, and if I join that, the concept of an oil paint with a canvas, if you're putting oil paint on a canvas, you're basically creating a picture. The picture is beautiful, it's basically talking to you. And that's the concept. I think everyone's talking about it, everyone's thinking about it, but has anyone really mastered it through the use of data, technology, analytics? Not yet. Machine learning and artificial intelligence are coming our way. They're knocking behind our back door, but again, you've not been able to harness the existing data that you've got. So the challenge is that machine learning and artificial intelligence, all this will fast track the way you operate. If you took, you know, because if you have, let's say, data in 15 different places and you want to basically create a real-time interaction. So let's see, me and you are talking and we've talked about and an ad relevant to that conversation needs to pop up. Think about that 10 years ago and think about that today without artificial intelligence and machine learning, that's not going to happen. But the idea is that because artificial learning and machine learning and what they're doing is they're basically stitching and they're looking at not only the conversation we're having now, but the conversation that we've had in the past and conversation people like you and me have had in the past. So there's n number of factors that they compute through, and all of a sudden at real time, they're able to bring that advanced analytics and bring that forward as a recommendation. That's what your next best action and your next best product recommendation engine actually do. It's not a human doing it, There are some rule-based targeting and rule-based setup that's done there, but it's the machine that's driving that. So to answer your question at a very grassroots level, no, just for the basic data, I think we're about maybe, and you are the expert in the AI and machine learning, so maybe you want to dive into, say, if I say the adoption of AI and machine learning really for any work related to marketing analytics is about 5 years, you know, from a maturity perspective.
Well, I would say it could speed up. It's depending on organization by organization. And the second thing is, people do not understand the power. People do not understand the... It's art and science, and that's what I usually say. It's art and science of analytics that people need to understand. And at the senior level, the problem is that someone is telling them, and I will not blame anyone but myself, because people like myself who stand on the stage and then talk about analytics and talk about all that things without spending more time with those C-level guys to explain to them how it is done. And then there are those large companies who want to run and sell their data products to them and say, well, hey, use this, use this, use this. And at the end, what happens is that they end up buying products that will collect more data, not knowing what to do with it. And that's a huge problem, because no one in the in that particular organization came from that background. So they don't know what it is all about. So it's like collecting more data. Okay, I'm collecting more data. I come from a school of thought that, hang on a minute, before collecting more data, first tell me what you're doing with the data you already have. And I was, like we were discussing earlier, I had this old company I was working with for the when I came to Australia in the first few days. And I asked them, what do you do with the, do you have website data? And they said, yes, we do have website data. I said, what do you do with it? He said, we store it on a hard drive. And in those days, 2 GB of hard drive was a big box. And then what do you do with it? So we store it for 5 years and then we throw it because they don't know what to do with it. And that is the problem, because there are lots of people who don't know what to do with that that data set that has been generated and what people are doing with that data. And so it is very important to educate right from the top, right to the C-level, whether it's the CEO or we drop the middle letter, with all the CEOs, and tell them that this is the art, this is what you can do with it. And I think that that responsibility lies with us, you, me, and all the people in our area who work in that space and talk to people. Again, storytelling plays a very important role in what we do at that space. Okay, coming back to you.
You raise a good point, because, you know, what's now happening, because you talked about this website data. So, you know, the way you look at it, targeting, retargeting and lookalike targeting, then you create that affinity group. And then that's how you basically try to do that engagement. And because you're not collecting that data, you're not creating those affinity groups, you exactly don't know, how do I differentiate between a website visitor A? And if it looks like a website visitor A, how do I basically differentiate that with website visitor B? And what's the affinity group? And the whole idea is that if you basically, and that, I know cookies basically going off, but that's the whole idea is that, and that's the power of digital marketing, is that you now have that first party data. So you need to rely on that first party. I used to call it like this, you know, every opportunity to interact with a customer for an organization is an opportunity to collect data, get more informed about that customer, get more enriched about that customer. And the only way you can do it is by collecting all that data. But to your point, collection on its own has no value. Mm-hmm. Unless and until you're able to take that step forward, how do I actually monetize that? And what is my strategy to monetize that? And how do I create that stickiness? And, you know, all these loyalty programs, especially the bigger retail organizations run, is on the monetization of that data. But, you know, and that's the space that I think is not really fully harnessed at this stage, but there's a lot of opportunity to do that.
No, absolutely. Data monetization is a huge space. People don't understand how to monetize the data they've got. Again, that brings to the fact that, oh, I just put it there and then throw it after 4 or 5 years because we don't need it. And actually, I tell you, I've got lots of that data that is lying in my, because I don't throw any data. That's a thumb rule. Never throw any data because you need it. You don't know when you will need it. And they were throwing it. I just said, give it to me. I'll keep it. Because data is, as you said, is the new oil. I would say data is the new blood. There are different acronyms and terminologies around it, but people need to know what to do with it, and that is very, very important. And that comes with a bit of art and science behind it. And so we go. Okay, guys, watching this, liking it, please put that in the comment section. What do you like about it? And also, please press the like button, share button, share it with as many people as possible. There is a lot of insights that are coming out of this discussion. Okay, Satya, Ferrari, this particular word brings something to mind?
Yes, yeah. You've caught it. I think in the last 10 global conferences that I've actually spoken in, I've actually used this word, metaphor Ferrari, or try to explain people what the Ferrari concept is. So what's the question?
What is it all about? Explain. So our audience also gets to know about it.
It's again, you know, it lies back to your earlier question when you talked about how many, you know, what CIOs and CMOs need to do and how the, what is the challenge about MarTech. So Ferrari is actually the word used in the marketing technology landscape as the shiny new toy. And when I say Ferrari is because, you know, if you're an automobile lover, you know, Ferrari is basically looked at the utopian of the cars, the best of best cars that can basically go at. I don't know the numbers. Maybe I'll have to ask my son what's the difference between Ferrari and Bugatti in terms of the speed, in terms of clicking on whatever that term is. But the whole idea, it's a very fast, robust car, right? So marketing technology, you know, everyone wants to have that robust infrastructure ecosystem to communicate with their customers in real time and basically manage all of that, know me, reach me, deliver a continuous, connected, consistent experience, all that marketing buzzwords. But so what's happening is that you bought this fancy toy, and I'll give you an analogy of an Excel, you know, Microsoft Excel. There's so many functions with the Microsoft Excel, but if you ask this question of people on the show today, I think people would say, give or take, we use 20% of that capability of Microsoft Excel, 80% remains unutilized. Same thing happens with the shiny toy as well. We buy this wonderful kit, but we only utilize 20% of that. 80% is unutilized. Now, why is this 80% utilized? One is because there's, you know, people don't want to change, the resistance to change, or they don't know how to use it, or they want to use it later. So that's where the Ferrari thing comes in. But for me, if you've bought the Ferrari, you need to basically do a few things before buying the Ferrari. And that's where my conversation is all about the concept of the fuel, the driver, and the road pit. So for me, the fuel is that, you know, as you have to drive the car can only drive if it has fuel in it. So ongoing maintenance. So, you know, we've talked about that budget concept. So how do you actually have this maintenance of this new shiny toy that you've got with your legacy system or your existing systems, and how do you actually integrate that with the other system, and how do you then scale it? So that's your fuel. Then the next element is the driver. So, you know, Michael Schumacher was the best in the F1 races. So the driver is that you need to have the right person or the pilot to drive this Ferrari, and what is their skill that is required? What's happening is people are buying the Ferrari. They're actually also employing or getting in the pilots or in that space as well. But they're not actually using the pilot to maneuver the Ferrari or drive the Ferrari, but they're using them as mechanics. Because the other thing is the pit. The pit is the strategy. So what you're trying to do, you know, you want to be a customer-centric organization. You know, you want to have customer value management. You have customer lifecycle journeys. You don't really have all that concept up and running. You don't have the right data in there, the right plumbing to make it happen, as a result of which the pit is not the right pit. So when the Ferrari's on the road, it's actually bumping. And every 2 kilometers or every 20 meters is actually moving forward, it's stopping. So what's happening is that the pilot is actually jumping off the Ferrari and opening the bonnet to really look at it and what's going on. So if you look at that analogy, so you know, my advice to senior leadership here is that when you're buying these wonderful pieces of technology, you really need to understand what is the strategy that we're looking at driving? What's our ROI going to be? What are our different use cases that we're basically putting forward to basically harness the capability that this product is actually offering? And then when you've got that, do we have the right people on board? And the right people means that you might not have them in the organization, or you might have them within the organization. So if you have them, but they're not at the right skill, how do you actually upskill them, cross-skill them, and train them? Or to do the heavy lifting and shifting in the earlier days, do you want to partner with a consulting firm or an external vendor, or bring in contractors to do that early days lifting and shifting for you, create a platform of stabilization. And once they've created that platform of stabilization, you start doing your incremental enhancement phase by phase by phase. I think so. That's why I keep talking about this Ferrari, and that's what my analogy was.
So I've got 2 points to make. I also have a Ferrari analogy. And I used to say to people that whenever I leave a company and I've got a big lull, I'm looking for a job. I know, you know what I look for? I look for people who've got lots of data, organization who've got lots of data, and they've got good money. And the reason for that is because I say to people, analytics is not bread and butter. It's like not taking you from one place to another, right? As a normal Toyota or a Ford, which will be able to take you from one place to another, which is point A to point B. That's what, you don't have analytics to do that. What analytics is a Ferrari. You will need more money, you will need more data, and you will need an expert to actually drive you, but it will actually take you so fast to the place you want to reach in no time, but you need to be, so it's nothing that is normally, you know, just taking you from point A to point B. It's about having that luxury. It's a luxury item, and not everyone can afford it, I think, and that's what it is. And when people try to get a Ferrari without understanding where it is going to take them and what it can do, well, you can ask for the moon, but where will you park it is the question, right? You can have a Ferrari, but if I live in a, I say to myself, if I live in a very down market house and I have a Ferrari parked outside, what will happen? Someone will come and scratch it. Everyone wants to have a look at it. You know, it'll be destroyed in no time. So it is important for people to understand what they're trying to ask, what they're asking for. I always say when you try to woo a girl and say, well, I'll get you the moon, right? They say that, right? All the time, boys say that. And then I come in and say, well, hang on a minute, I'll get you the moon. Where do you want to park it? Do you have a big parking lot for moon to be parked? No answer. There is nothing. So you don't want the moon then? So be very careful what you're asking for. Because if you're asking for that, then the whole mission, the whole organization needs to be behind that to actually work towards it. Otherwise, it's just yet another place to be. And there is a challenge around that. People do not understand what it can deliver and what value it can bring in.
I think you've made a good point, because that leads to the, as to what the value it brings in. It brings in a great value of experience, but the question is that who actually owns the experience? And it's not actually sitting. I think that when I wrote this paper in Accenture about the future of marketing, one of the things that we try to cover off is that who owns the experience? Is that the CEO? Is that the chief experience officer, that the new position that was described in? Or is that the CMO? But the reality is that it's not about the C-level. It's everyone within the organization from ground zero to the highest person actually owns that experience. And when you bring all that together, that's how you're going to manage it. So I guess if you look at a point solution 10, 15 years ago, a lot of organizations, they were extreme focused on product and channel. As a result of which, the customer was getting lost. You had duplication in processes. You had monolithic, CRM was coined in maybe 60s, 70s, and it was really booming up. It was more about that monolithic structure of CRM that was more for billing and transactional system. It was not around the behavior of, behavioral analytics and driving it. And I guess if you move forward with this new concept of what are you going to do and what are you asking for, it's more about the behavioral analytics that you want, and all that behavioral analytics data that you're capturing, to use that to basically provide and resonate a powerful customer communication.
Good stuff. I totally agree with you. I think people need to get a good understanding, and it needs to be run through the organization, across the organization. And I think that is changing. It is taking a bit of time, but the organizations who've actually embraced it quite quickly are far ahead than the organization who's still trying to get there, well, slowly and steadily. Well, where they will stay, what they will do, will depend on time that's going on. Okay, let's move on to the next question. But before that, guys, got a question? Got something that you think about marketing? Put that in the comment section. I'll take that. I will share that experience, if that was an experience, if that was a question, in just a section after this, after I finish my questions with Satya. I'm meeting him after a long time, so I need to ask him a lot of questions. Okay, Satya, next question to you around digital transformation. So the world is changing. Everything is becoming, because COVID happened and everything is now becoming digital. How has that changed marketing? And I did that last week with Zarina as well, when Zarina came onto the show, and I asked the same question. Digital transformation, is it changing a lot in digital digital marketing as well? How has that impacted digital marketing? What do you think?
So I think digital transformation in itself has had a big role. And you know, what you do, what you want to do today, and how, where you are today, and where you want to be in the future from a people, process, data, technology, and system. What digital transformation has done, or actually COVID has done, is actually accelerated that. So one of the things I used to talk about, you know, there's a lot of things that happen in consulting language where they talk about, but, you know, they actually, consulting language talks at at an exponential speed, whereas organizations react to that at a snail pace, as a result of which the change that is expected from what's happening or what could happen and how organizations respond to that is very, very slow. Digital transformation is actually taking, you know, you talked about that Ferrari and it takes you at a very accelerated speed. That is what COVID has done to digital transformation. And coming back to, you know, that concept of digital and digital transformation, I think then people need to understand what exactly is digital. And when you talk about digital, what does that really mean? So is that actually a technology? I would say it's not actually a technology. It's actually a new way of doing things. Yep. It's actually a way of engaging with the customer that you have not done in the past because we did not know how to do that. Mm-hmm. It's coordination of different technologies, whether it's analytics, whether it's cloud, whether it's social media, whether it's API integration, and how do you do that? And when you're trying to do that, you're also looking at re-examining the way you're currently doing business. And when you're re-examining the current way of doing business, then you start looking at, I'm doing the same thing. Is there a better way of doing it? Is there a simpler way of doing it? Can I standardize that? Can I make it consistent? And then you start looking at new ways of doing new things and new ways of doing the same thing. And then when you start doing it that way, then you start looking at what are the new frontiers I can open up for my organization or for myself that can create value. And then when you talk about, so that's the framework that people need to understand. That exactly is what digital transformation is. So something that you were doing manually, now you can do it in an automated fashion, in a seamless way behind what, in, especially if you're looking in banking and telcos, something is called straight through processing. What that means is that tomorrow, if in a banking organization, you want to apply for a home loan, you sign a paper documentation, someone actually will look at it. Then someone in credit operations is going to look at it and basically validate your documentation, and then a decision is going to be made. Now, if I can basically have all the APIs connected with all the different organizations where I need to connect with in real time, as soon as I make my application, my license could be checked with the RTA in Sydney. And if I have a banking relationship with other with open banking, maybe that gets stitched through. And all that can happen pretty much in real time, seamlessly behind the scene. And I can get an answer, which I was getting in 15 days, 20 days, maybe in 5 days, maybe in 1 day. And that's where it is looking at. So what digital transformation is doing, or what digital is actually doing, is basically putting the customer at the forefront. So whatever you do, you basically have that customer first mindset, and everything that you do is that value to the brand, or is that value to the customer? And previously and traditionally, what's happened is when I said about customers are more, it's more about products and channels, mm-hmm. where we're always talking about the value to the brand or the value to the organization. We were never customer-centric, as a result of which the customer was always second. Digital transformation is allowing you to be customer-first and putting that customer right on top and top of mind. And when you're doing that from a transformation landscape, what does that mean is that instant feedback, your real-time, it's automated, it's intelligent, it's online. And you're looking at that, you know, always on, always processing process where there's always room for improvement. So that's what exactly is a digital transformation. So if any organization is saying, I'm a digital native, and mm-hmm. they don't have those, you know, what I've talked about being customer first, they're not looking at understanding the new frontiers of value, they're not actually looking at the current way they're operating and how they can actually be more agile, how can they be more nimble in communicating with their customer, making things seamless for the customer, it's not going to happen. So that's where digital and digital transformation comes in.
Good stuff. I totally agree with you. And at this point, I'll ask a question to the audience. And the question is, guys, if you see digital transformation, what is driving digital transformation in your organization? Is that is either CIO, the CEO, the CTO, or COVID-19? That is the question I've asked every time to people. And overwhelmingly, the answer comes out to be, I'm not going to say that to you, but you tell me what is driving digital transformation in your organization. And that reminds me of two things. You know, I was in a large retailer. I've worked at both, so I don't want to name any of the two. It'll be one of the two. So I used to have that discussion where one lady came to me and she said, you know what, Shilindra, why do we change? We have been doing this for last 100 years and we've been generating revenue like anything. We don't need to change. And my answer was, and I'm now coining for you, Satya, to be taken. It's in the book as well, because I mentioned that a few years ago. If you keep on doing what you're doing, you will keep on getting what you're getting. And that was one reason, one liner that I mentioned, and I left the company. Because if you don't change, if you keep on doing what you're doing, is what you're going to get. And that is what digital transformation has made, that change in the world, where you got to make a difference, you got to make a change in the way you approach any problem that you're finding. And digital transformation has opened up a Pandora box. And that came through because you were saying that, you know, we have to change the way we are not going to do what we're doing. So the answer is, if you keep on doing what you're doing, you'll keep on getting what you're getting.
I think just to add on to that, I'll make another annotation. You know, you can't live in the containers of the past. So what made you successful yesterday is not going to make you successful tomorrow as well. And a great example, I think I was presenting in BTOS earlier this year, when we talked about the fact that a good example was someone asked the CEO of Blockbuster, mm-hmm. hey, what's Netflix is coming along. Yep. And what's your view on Netflix? And the response he gave was, well, thank you very much for asking that question. Netflix is not on our radar. Now, you fast track that 20, 25 years ago today, well, Blockbuster is not in the radar of entertainment.
No, but Netflix was created because of Blockbuster. Because Blockbuster didn't give that guy, the CEO of Netflix, the DVD he wanted. And he said, let me create one myself. And here is the platform ready for you, reaching everyone's house. And I don't think any household, at least in Australia, which doesn't have Netflix.
Yeah, I think that's why, you know, when you're looking at this digital transformation, you really need to be a disruptor. Mm-hmm. And you might not have very early adopters of your solution, but if you've really got a good business case and you put it forward, you know, the early adopters can then gradually, you know, become fast followers and encourage that. So I guess that's why, you know, digital disruption and digital transformation are currently being used interchangeably.
Yeah, it's all about what you do with your data. That's very, very important. And if you don't know what to do with your data, you've got two guys here you can talk to and they can help you understand what you do with your data. Okay, next question, and possibly my last question. Campaign management. Let's talk about a bit around campaign management. But before I go there, guys, where are your questions? Audience, put your questions in the comment section. So many people watching this and I'm loving it. Please, please, please put your question in the comment section. Quiz us, quiz Satya. You won't get access to Satya like this again. So put that in the comment section. Any question that is in your mind, any comment or anything that you want to reinforce or endorse, please put that in the comment section. More people say stuff, better it is. We want to learn from you as well. And also, please don't forget to like and share this video with as many people as possible. Campaign management. And as we come to campaign management, how do you look at tracking and measurement of campaigns currently that are going on? Well, tell us about that. So when I joined one of the large retailers, campaign management was fine, but it was more around evaluation of it and optimizing the campaign, which is very important. So please tell us about that.
That's very close to my heart, and I'll share a personal experience that I heard about you at that time when you were the retailer that you were talking about. So I guess, what exactly is a campaign? People need to understand, a campaign is actually a marketing activity, yes, but it's actually a problem solving exercise. So the problem solving, what's the business problem that we've got? And we actually solve that with a campaign. And that means that I've got a problem in retention. So I've got a leaking bucket, and maybe I've got a specific segment in my population that is a leaking bucket. So I need to address that. And the way I address that is I send out an offer, which is a value proposition, and I communicate that customer with a channel, email, SMS, telemarketing, direct mail, whatever that is, push notification, you name it, there are so many channels to do that. So that in a very nutshell is campaign management. So when you do that, when you communicate that with that customer, the customer has the ability to either take up the offer or not take up the offer, depending on how enticing that offer is. And maybe you have thought about the offer to be great, but the perception of the customer could be different. You've thought to, I've communicated with Shailendra on email, but maybe Shailendra is better on receptive on mobile. So there's a lot of things that happen in that space. So you do something which is called test and learn and experimentation. So whenever you run out a campaign, it's not that if it worked or it did not work. So is it praiseworthy or is it blameworthy? The idea is that if it did not work, why did it not work? And what elements can be changed? Can we change the creative? Can we make some changes in the data? Can we basically make it in the opt-in, you know, whether it's the subject line headers, the reminder that we are sending out, is that an email, SMS, follow-up? So you need to change those permutation and combination and evolve. And through that evolution, what will happen, and you know, this is a very good term from biology, is that we are evolving. And the way we are evolving is from the past learnings. So something that in civilization that did not work, you know, better. So the survival of the fittest, or use and disuse of organs from Lamarck, the theory that was given, it was all about getting to the better. So the way you only can get better is that if you tried and you experiment. Now the challenge that you've got at an organizational level is, what is our attitude towards risk and what is our appetite towards failure to drive that? And so it actually comes from the top. And if you look at a lot of marketing organization, because marketing becomes a support function, if you ask a campaign manager, what would you like, prioritize between campaign execution and campaign reporting, they will always say, focus on the execution, not on the reporting. But I guess if you change the whole wheel around and say, focus on the reporting, that starts giving you some valuable insights of what's worked and what has not worked. So, you know, when we talk about it's analytically driven, you know, statistically empowered, all that stuff, data can actually help you drive that. I guess that measurement experimentation is gradually evolving. And I know you are a great fan of experimentation, design of experiments, and I'll share a personal story. I went to SAS for a 3-day training for design of experiments. And I had two people who had come from the retailer that you were working for, where you were heading up. And he said, you know, we got our boss, Shelly, and you know, if we don't actually master this in 3 days, he's basically going to be behind our back. So it comes back to the fact that, you know, the leaders need to really embrace that, and they need to understand why experiment is important, what value experiments bring on the table. And effectively, you know, you take the emotions out from the discussion, and you are actually having a discussion with anyone, any person in the organization, whatever seniority they have, you're actually having it on fact. And whenever you're basically you're putting your points forward, which is a fact-based decision making, it's always better than, you know, rationale or emotional or gut feel.
You know, to your point on design of experiments, even today, I speak to so many people and they've got no freaking idea of what design of experiments is. And I tell them, then how are you running campaigns if you don't even know what design of experiment? That's the first step in even designing what you're trying to design. What are you trying to build on? And people have no clue. And I was like, I was talking to one of a very senior person quite recently, and we were discussing about stuff. And the moment I said design of experiments, they said, you've opened a new box for us. I said, well, hang on a minute. This is old school. I'm not even talking, this is nothing that has come up yesterday. I used to use it 15 years ago. You don't know what design of experiments is? He said, no, I don't. I said, well, sorry, you got to learn. And I think that is also missing, and that is missing because, and I'll give you a reason for that, because technology, because of a lot of automation is coming in through and people are trying to put in data and get something out as a result. I used to tell people, if 10 people, and that was when, and I can say that now, KXN was there, and they said, well, anyone can build a model now. I said, yeah, anyone can build a model. But then who is going to decide whose model is better than whose model? I don't know what you've put in. I don't know what he's put in inside it. And I don't know what the output. Who's going to use it? Who's going to take the responsibility that when that model actually gets executed and gets into a delivery mode, that there will be enough responses to that particular campaign? No answer.
I think, you know, one of the things that you talk, Shailendra, you know, that technology influence. So, you know, when we, at those days, when you talk about A-B testing or multivariate testing, a lot of that has been actually taken by technology. And a lot of experimentation and design that's actually happening is now actually also happening on the creative and content side in UX and UI. So there's a there's another experimentation that people are talking about, which is more on the UX, UI, creative and content. But I think what we are talking about is more hypothesis testing and design of experiments, and is more on the data side. And I've been actually very fortunate to be working with one of the senior leaders at Citi today, who is really passionate as you. And he's basically anything that he's, any campaign that we are running and we're trying to do a forecasting, he's basically saying, okay, where's the design of experiments? Where's the hypothesis? What's your null hypothesis? So if you're not having a null hypothesis, don't even bring a crowd across any campaign that you're basically saying you're measuring. But what are you measuring against? And to your point, you know, I think it's also important that how many leaders are like there who really understand the significance, importance, and actually step-by-step way of doing this, you know. What's your control group? What percentage of the population should be in the control group as compared to the target? What is the difference between target and control, and how do you measure lift? You know, I think these are the fundamental basics that are required in any campaign management, you know, a tool or an analyst. And that's why when you talk about, you know, when 10 years ago, when you talked about the data analyst, you know, you should be able to paint the picture, tell the story and join the dots. I think these are the elements that are really required in today's analysts to drive that. And I guess as we mature with machine learning and artificial intelligence, a lot of these different data points are going to come through, and you know, you have to make those decisions pretty much in nanoseconds. And the job descriptions of data analysts is going to be changing. You know, we have data engineers and we've got database people and you've got data analysts and things, but I think there's some neuroscientists, there's, you know, there's a lot of, and you're the expert, so you can come up with a few naming standards as well. And I knew I presented somewhere and they talked about, you know, yeah, oh, I've got it here actually. So they were talking about neuro A-B testers or sixth sense analysts, micro interaction specialists, master storyteller, you know, yeah. there's so many names that are coming up.
Well, hang on a minute. 10 years ago, we didn't have data scientists. And today, everyone is a data scientist today. I don't know how, but you go to LinkedIn, type data scientist in Australia, you'll find 200,000 of those.
That's pretty interesting, because and sometimes I look at that and I amuse myself, is that this entire concept of machine learning, artificial intelligence, data science, data-led, you know, storytelling, maybe data-led storytelling minus that, has been in the business for 3-5 years, you know, in more common, you know, common terminology and common speaking. And if someone says I've been a data scientist for 10 years, how do you actually correlate that?
No, I ask a very different, I'll ask you another question. I'll give you an example. Sorry, I'll give you a story, not a question. The story is that I was at one of the largest software companies in the world. Don't want to name them. I have a lot. And I started talking about building an analytics capability globally. And I said, this is what we need to do. So they decided to pick someone else in UK. And they said, well, she's going to run this. And I said, as long as I'm being served with the people, I'm fine. So after two months, I was really frustrated. So I gave her a call. And I said, I still remember I was in front of Kmart. And I gave her a call and I said, what's happening? How are you putting people in? What's going on? So she said to me, Shelley, don't worry. We will build COEs in different parts of the world. I said, okay. So where is my COE? Is it going to be in India or Philippines? Where? No. We will have one in Melbourne. I said, one in Melbourne? How? She said, no, we'll get people in Melbourne. I said, where are the people? Where are those people who are going to do the work in Melbourne? Do you have those people? She said, where are you? I said, I'm in the car. I said, can you open your phone? I opened my phone. Can you go to LinkedIn? I said, okay, I did. Can you type data scientist? I typed. there are 200,000 data scientists there. We can pick 10% of that, which is still a fair big number. I said, tell you, in Australia, there are only 8 or 9 data scientists in true sense, not more than that. I don't know where the remainder are, but if everyone just changes their title to being a data scientist, how do they become a data scientist? Will they be coming in and doing the job which I asked them to do? I doubt. That is the problem. Everyone is a data scientist now with 20 years of experience, 15 years of experience. The term itself is only 5 years old. And I, when I try to define the word data science, and I said, this is what you got to do, I can't find one person who can do all of the components of data scientists. Even I can't. I don't know. I can't do data engineering. I can't do 500 out of these things that they claim to be the data scientist doing. I don't understand how this is happening. Beyond me. But that's life. Guys, sorry, I got nostalgic. Anyone who's got any questions, please put that in the comment section and I'll take that very, very soon in just 2 to 3 minutes. So guys, that's where we're at. Satya, you want to add something to that or should I move on to the audience?
Oh, you can move on to the audience. We had a good call.
There are quite a few questions out there.
Thank you very much, Shailendra. It's been a pleasure talking to you. I've enjoyed the conversation so far.
Okay, let's get to the audience Q&A. So guys, this is the audience Q&A section. If you've got a question, this is your last opportunity to put that in the comment section and I'll pick that up and I'll take that to Satya. Please, please, please put that question in the comment section. It is coming now. So we get into the audience Q&A. Okay, guys. So here we go with the questions first. Let's start with the questions and the comments. Please put that in the comment section if you've got one. Otherwise, I'm taking them anyways. Let's start. The first question is from Santosh Pyle and he says, nice to see you, Satya. Hi, Santosh. How are you? Let's discuss the role of CMO in this. Traditional CMOs don't fully grasp the concept of data-driven marketing, let alone AI/ML-driven behavioral or experience-led marketing.
Thanks, Santosh, and nice to see you. Thanks for watching and posting that question. Great. I guess, you know, one of the things that the way I've looked, and again, and apologies, this is going to be very coming out of the heart, and Shailendra, you like it as well. And we just had a good segue from machine learning and artificial intelligence and data science. What has happened? So let me, you know, when we started off this conversation, I talked about the father of marketing being Kotler, and every student in marketing doing an MBA or master's program actually reads Kotler from the 1960s, and I don't know whether it's 23rd or which edition now has gone through. But if you look at until 1990 or anything, the concept of marketing was always above the line. So, and if you look at, you know, by the time, and this is not about a startup CMO who is just a uni grad who's got some great ideas, you know, and I think we have some wonderful examples of startups in Australia and globally, people have really done well, but established banking organization, insurance, telco, consulting firms are minus because they actually get a lot of experience. But any traditional organization which is really main scale global, their CMOs would be aging the retirement ages today, anything 50 to 55, 60. And when they graduated, I don't think so these concepts of data-driven marketing, analytics, and how to do these things actually were coined. So they grew up more with the brand personas. You know, personalization was more around above the line marketing and how do you do PR, advertising, and brand promotion and sales promotion. And sales promotion was a big thing that was happening at that point in time. So that was one, that's my, again, my personal feel. But over a period of time, you know, they get coached and they get trained and they start grasping that. The other thing, if you start looking at, is the average tenure of a CMO or a CEO is reducing. So maybe earlier it was about 5 years, but latest research shows it became 3, and I think now it's actually gone to 2.8 or something. So for a CMO to come in an organization and do a mover and shaker, he's pretty got anything from 0 months to 36 months, and he has to transform the organization, you know, and deliver. And delivery is really the key focus. So in that space, the fear of failure is also inherent in some part of the mind. So, you know, if you look at, you know, your strengths, so people actually want to play on their strengths, not on their weaknesses. So they play their cards based on their strengths. And if analytics is not their strength, they'll not play their cards on that. Again, and this is my personal view. But this is what I feel that this is one thing that is really where CMOs really need to step up and drive that. And I'll give you an analogy, you know, why most CMOs are not CEOs. And this is a very common annotation that CEOs are dealing with numbers, but CMOs are also dealing with numbers. The only challenge is that CEOs actually make sense of those numbers pretty much in a very quick turnaround time, digest the information, come back and play it back, and then run with it. I think CMOs take a bit time to absorb that, digest it, and play with. But it's the same thing. It's a matter of how do we actually drive that in that direction.
I totally understand and agree with that because, you know, the other challenge is it's not only CMOs. It's other people as well. And I remember one of my PhDs at Woolies used to say, Shelley, there was a story. There was a guy who used to come to us every time we used to have a problem where we wanted to use statistical modeling. He would say, I'll do slice and dice and get it done. And I used to be very upset. So this guy, this PhD came to me and, I'll name it, Bakir came to me and said, don't be upset. I said, why? He said, this is what he knows best, slicing and dicing. So for every problem, the solution is slicing and dicing for him. Whereas that may not be the right problem, the solution. So that is the problem. This is what the CMOs of the current generation actually were trained in that fashion. And that's what they know, that's what they know best. And that's what they want to do, actually. And I totally understand where you're coming from. Okay, let's move on to the next question. Next question or message is from Vikram Pava and says, good afternoon, Satya. Do you feel because... Okay, let's go to the question itself. I think he's messed up. Press the enter button quickly. Good afternoon, Satya. Do you feel psychologists would play a bigger role in future to dissect the data to create more human touch marketing messages that go out to customers in real time? And will that create a job scarcity because the sector is moving?
It's a great question, Vikram. Good afternoon. I don't know which part of the world you are from, but it's fantastic to hear that question. And you know, psychologists would definitely play a very big role in the making of data-driven marketing in the future, and maybe not in the very near future. It's about it's not that far away. So no, we've talked about data analysts, we've talked about data engineers, we've talked about data developers, we've talked about that word. But in that psychologist world, you know, if you had a chance to look at the few of the words that I use, you're looking at neuro A/B testers, sixth sense analysts, you know, micro interaction specialists, master storytellers. Again, these data scientists, if they actually get, you know, on top of a psychology degree, that's what's going to lead to. So neuro A/B testers is nothing but actually looking at the neurons in terms of what you're thinking. So me and Shelley are talking and we're thinking after this conversation, we're going to have a coffee or a beer and we're going to hang out, you know, and there's an ad coming through, you know, $5 off on your nearest being a Friday, you know, early beer. So that neuro A/B tester is looking at your, and that sixth sense analyst is actually looking at your sensory things, you know, before you actually spit something out from your mouth, your sensory movements automatically are actually depicting and telling that story altogether. How do you pick those micro moments of interaction and really see, is that going to be a positive or a negative? That's on the cards. And just wait another 5 years, and anyone who's got a data science or a data degree with psychology, you would be in demand.
You know what? I need to give two comments, one example and one comment. So the comment is actually, anyone who's doing analytics, modeling, data science, or whatever you call it, has to think like a customer. And that is very, very important. And that's when you do that by nature, you need to think having the psychology of the customer, just because you need to justify what you've done when you're presenting to the business, or when you're talking to the business about it, to take that decision to win their confidence. And an example of that was, and this is someone common between you and me, Satyan, I won't name him. Later he worked for him in another organization, a great friend of mine. We were talking about mobile phones, recharges on mobile phones. So he came to me, I was in the corridor and we were standing there, and he said, Shelley, I think, now this is psychology, I think that there is a correlation between wine and people doing recharges. Can you have a look? I said, okay, I'll have a look. And we did, and we ran a campaign, and we ran a very successful campaign on putting recharge to people who bought wine. And it was a huge success. And then I met that guy again, don't want to name him, and you would remember who that is. And he said to me, Shelley, I said, how did you think about this? He said, it's a very simple thing. When people get drunk, they start making phone calls. Is that true? I said, absolutely true. And that reminded me of the fact that when I used to come from the city back home, all I was doing was making frantic phone calls because I had a good time and I wanted to talk to more people. Reality check. People need to, data scientists, analytics, marketing guys have to think like a customer. And when they have to think like a customer, they want to get into that particular situation and get an answer to that. And exactly that what happened.
If I could, with your permission, Shelley, I had a similar example. I had one of my previous bosses. He was also a great fan of data and analytics. And he was actually, you know, when I worked with him, I learned a lot from him. He gave another analogy. You know, when we talk about this big data concept, and he was talking about if you're actually working in a multi, you know, if you're working in a place which is a multi-storied organization, so you've got multiple, you know, levels and multiple, you know, offices for different organization in that building. Just by looking at that lift movement, you can actually see which organization is doing better as compared to worse. Or if you go to ask the receptionist, you know, where the inquiries are coming in, not talking about COVID today and a lot of inquiries coming through the web interface and virtually, but, you know, when people used to actually physically come and meet, you know, prospecting was done and lead generation was done through, you know, physical presence and coming to the office. So he said the footfall itself will determine the success of an organization and how their ROI is and how they're actually doing on stocks. So you can actually buy stocks based on just, again, so that's it's an example. So again, it's saying, you know, there's a lot of data that's there, but how do you actually mine that? You know, that's the sixth sense analyst that's coming in there, but it's just not the analyst without, you know, sixth sense or something basically striking, but there's a data that's coming into the nervous system and talking to you and creating that story, painting that picture, and then you're basically spitting it out.
No, absolutely, and I totally agree with you that. Vikram, hopefully you got the answer to the question. If you've got any other question, please put that in the comment section. I'll take that. Move on to the next comment. It's from Vameed Al-Haraji, and he says, well done. I don't know whether you know him or, you know.
So Vameed, me and Vameed have worked together in some organizations. Great to see you.
Good stuff, Vameed. If you've got a question, put that in the comment section. We'll take that. Next comment is from Professor Dr. Anita Singh, and she says, nice to listen to your views. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Anita. Okay, Aditi Basin and has got a question. He said, thanks, Satya, really enlightening. Very helpful to understand the transition of traditional marketing to data-driven marketing. And thanks, Shalendra. I'm going to use your quote further with the copyright attributed to you. Thank you, Aditi. I saw a long write-up. I thought that was a question. That looks like a comment. Thank you very much. You can use the comment. It's there. It's in the public domain. You can use it whenever you want. It's all there. It's not, and if you've got a question, please put that in the comment section. Okay. Finally, I've got one more comment as of now, and that is from RTG. Thank you, RTG, in the true sense. Always knowledgeable. That's where we're at. So thank you very much. So those were the questions. Anyone having a question? You've got another 10 seconds. Put that in the comment section and I'll take that. Otherwise, we're good with all the questions there. Thank you for everyone for your patience and listening to us. I think this was quite happening live, and there were lots of people who were watching across all the platforms. I was going through various platforms while we were asking questions and doing this. And there were not many people watching it. So thank you very much, guys, for watching this episode. And it's always fun bringing in people like Satya who come from the industry and have worked in various parts of the world and shared their experiences. If you've got a question, I can still take one last. But anyways, if not, we should move on. Satya, Thank you very much for your time. Before you go, I always ask my guests to give one statement or one thing you want the audience to leave with in less than, in about a sentence. What do you think? What do you want to leave the audience with?
So firstly, thank you very much, Shailendra, for giving me this opportunity. It's been really an honor coming on your show and talking about my journey and enlightening people about what marketing analytics is all about. One thing, you know, if I had to, you know, I'm a very inspirational and a passionate leader, and I like leading teams and driving people for success. And people ask me a very difficult question: how do you prioritize things in life, and what's the strategy that you've got? So I look at, you know, you're always juggling with things in life. And when you're juggling with multiple balls, there's a chance that you actually drop a ball. So which is the ball that you drop and which is the ball that you don't drop, and how do you actually manage that from a prioritization side? Is that if you're juggling with multiple balls, you've got two different types of ball. One ball is made out of rubber, which means that if you drop it, there's a chance it'll rebound and you get a second chance to catch it. The other ball that you're juggling with is made out of glass. If you drop it, you basically tarnish it. So reputation is everything. And how do you build and manage it? Basically, you take the analogy of your glass ball and your rubber ball. Something that you basically once drop is dropped forever. Something that you drop has a second chance to catch.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Thank you very much, Satya. Before you go, I've got Vikram saying something. And he says, thank you for the answer, guys. I'm based in Sydney. Love the chat. Good stuff. Thank you, Vikram. Thank you for your time. And I really enjoyed the conversation as much as you did. So thank you very much. Thank you, Satya. It was a pleasure having you on the show. I thoroughly enjoyed the conversation. I think we are having this conversation after how many? 10 years or so?
10 years, yes.
We had that last conversation at, I think it was the ADMA event.
It was the ADMA event in the art house at Pitt Street.
good stuff. Thank you very much, and thank you for your time. And I look forward to speaking to you soon.
Thank you very much, Alain. Thank you very
and
much.
And when everything opens up, we will catch up for a drink.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thanks. So, guys, that was Satya Upadhyay from Citibank. I hope you enjoyed the conversation. I had absolute fun. I enjoyed it. Now, guys, if you're watching this episode on any of the platforms, all you need to do is like and share with as many people as possible so that people can learn from it, whether you're watching LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, wherever. Please share it with as many people as possible. If you're watching it on Facebook, though, please share it with other groups as well, which are marketing related or direct marketing related groups, so that more and more people can learn from what Satya had to offer today. And it was great insights. I don't think normally people get to learn from people like Satya. It was great, great fun. And please share it. And if you're watching this episode on Twitter, LinkedIn, please follow me. You get to hear more and more from senior leaders from the industry, and I bring them off and on. Please try to do it twice a week. And if you're watching this on YouTube, please press the subscribe button and press the bell icon so that you can be alerted when a live show is on. So thank you very much for watching. Before I go, I would like to give that away again. Link Plus AI is the new app that can help you optimize your LinkedIn profile and also give you some more insights about what you project to the world. So this is what you need to do. Just scan this QR code and use the invite code 611074 to actually get in. It's invite only, and it's only exclusive for my audience, which I've got. So please, please, please use that. And you can press the invite button and invite your friends as well as you go forward. So please download the app and use it. It is free, no ads, and invite only. Over to you. That's only for you. So thank you very much. And it was pleasure for all of you watch the show. Thank you very much. And look forward to you coming back. I'll come back very soon and with another guest. Bye now. Take care.